change matters to life on land, but the oceans, they're so big. They'll be fine, right? When we talk about climate change, we don't usually talk about the oceans. Instead, one of the first things we hear about is global temperature. That's air temperature up here where we live. Air temperature is measured every day by thousands of weather stations around the whole world, using thermometers about 2 meters, or just over 6 feet, off the ground. When we stitch together all of those records, we get global average temperature, the most commonly used measure of how fast our planet is warming. Air temperature is such a common measure of climate change that when all the countries in the world got together in December 2015 to hammer out the Paris Agreement, they decided to use global temperature to define its targets. The nations that signed the Paris Agreement agreed to hold the increase in global average temperature to well below 2 degrees Celsius, that's about 3.5 degrees Fahrenheit, above pre-industrial levels. But is global air temperature really the best measure of how fast our planet is warming? Many scientists would say no. Ever since the Industrial Revolution, carbon dioxide has been building up in the atmosphere. It's a direct result of using coal, oil, and natural gas for our energy. Carbon dioxide and other gases like it are wrapping an extra blanket around the planet, trapping heat inside the climate system that would otherwise radiate out to space. Where is this heat going? Over 90% of it hasn't been going into the atmosphere where it can be measured by weather stations. No, it's been going into the ocean. And the world's oceans are warming at much faster rates than previously thought, both at the surface and at depth. How much hotter have they gotten? As one article recently put it, ocean heat accumulation is the equivalent of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 Hiroshima bombs exploding every second since 1990. Why do we care about a warmer ocean? These record-breaking ocean temperatures we've seen in recent years have been fueling stronger hurricanes. They've been altering our weather patterns, and they have been profoundly affecting marine ecosystems. Record warm ocean temperatures in 2016, exacerbated by a strong El Nino, devastated the Great Barrier Reef. Heat stress damaged the algae living in the coral, resulting in bleaching. Bleached coral can bounce back, but it takes years and most of it is lost forever. After the 2016 event, Australian scientists went to assess the damage. They estimated that 2/3 of the whole northern part of the Great Barrier Reef is now dead. You can understand why one scientist called it the saddest research trip of his life. Even if the world meets that 2-degree target set by the Paris Agreement, only a fraction of the world's coral reefs that hold an amazing 25% of ocean species are forecast to survive by the end of the century. And it isn't just about the coral. Around the world, warmer temperatures have been linked to increased risk of disease in a whole range of fish, shellfish, and even marine mammals like seals and dolphins. Marine species are on the move too, trying to change where they live to keep up with warming temperatures. The tiny organisms that form the base of the food chain are clocking in the fastest changes. A poleward shift of 100 kilometers, or over 60 miles per decade for zooplankton, and over 400 kilometers, that's 250 miles per decade for phytoplankton. The US National Climate Assessment concludes that these changes will alter the distribution and the abundance and the productivity of many marine species. This is a concern not just for natural systems, but for us as well. Because according to the United Nations, about 1 billion people around the world depend on fish for their primary source of protein. Most of these people live in poor developing countries. If the marine food web falls apart, so does theirs too. And the phytoplankton we were just talking about, they also produce about half of the oxygen that we breathe. And not just us, most living organisms need oxygen to survive. And it turns out that warmer water holds less oxygen. So the warmer the ocean, the lower the amount of dissolved oxygen in the ocean. It's estimated that for each degree Celsius, or 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit, that the world warms, oxygen levels in the ocean will go down by 2%. Now, for some parts of the ocean, it isn't really a big deal, but where it really matters are the oxygen minimum zones that lie off the coasts just under many of the most productive fishing areas in the world. As climate changes, these oxygen minimum zones are expanding sideways and upwards. This is shrinking valuable habitat for fish, affecting commercial fisheries and the local economy. Recent die-offs during temporary low oxygen events off the coast of Oregon and in the Gulf of Mexico show how sensitive fish and shellfish can be to oxygen levels. And the number of dead zones around the world, so-called because most organisms can't live there because there isn't enough oxygen, they've been doubling each decade since the 1960s due to both pollution and warming. All of this sounds bad enough, but there's one more big problem to complete the trifecta of devastating ways that climate change affects the world's oceans. We know the ocean is taking up more than 90% of the extra heat in the climate system, but did you know the ocean is also taking up about a quarter of all the carbon we produce from burning fossil fuels every year? Since the dawn of the Industrial Revolution, oceans have absorbed 550 billion tons of carbon dioxide. That's the amount of carbon that would be stored in about 150 billion trees. Once carbon dioxide dissolves into the ocean, it turns into carbonic acid. This lowers the pH level of the ocean, making it more acidic. That's why this problem is known as ocean acidification. Why do we care? Because a more acidic ocean makes it more difficult for phytoplankton, those same phytoplankton we talked about earlier that make up the base of the food chain and produce half the oxygen we breathe. It makes it harder for them to form their shells and for coral to form their skeletons too. Acidification reduces the amount of calcium carbonate in the water. That's the mineral that's one of the key building blocks for shells and reefs. Sea creatures that do grow shells can even see them dissolve if conditions are acidic enough. And today, the ocean is 30% more acidic than it was 200 years ago. We don't live in the ocean, but we care about it all the same. Whether it's the stunning beauty of dolphins leaping or sea life in coral reefs swaying in the tide, or whether it's acknowledging the irreplaceable and fundamental services that the ocean provides to maintain human life on this planet. The potential consequences of climate change for the ocean are enormous. Ocean heat content, oxygen levels, and acidification, these all join global air temperature as indicators that are vital to track the health of our planet and the impact that human activities are having on one of our most important resources. Thank you for watching Global Weirding. Be sure to check out globalweirdingseries.com every other Wednesday for a new episode. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube page, like us on Facebook, and follow me on Twitter. Have a question about climate change? We want to hear it. We'll have a live Q&A on our Facebook page every other Thursday at 7 p.m. Central. See you next time.